Pass your commercial pilot checkride. Your examiner's favorite checkride questions by Jason Schappert. Read to you by me, Jason Schappert. As you get ready to take your commercial pilot checkride, you already know what to expect. Certainly from your private pilot checkride, no matter how long ago that was, and perhaps even from an instrument pilot checkride along the way. You know what the oral exam is going to be like. You know there's a flying portion. Our goal here is to unmask the secrets behind that commercial pilot checkride. One of the biggest mistakes I believe student pilots make, and we're all student pilots, especially on the commercial pilot checkride, is they believe the notion that a commercial pilot checkride is just a glorified private pilot checkride. If anyone has ever said that to you, or you've said that to anyone, I need you to remove that from your vocabulary because it's absolutely false. The notion that a commercial pilot checkride is a glorified private pilot checkride is absolutely false. I almost failed my commercial pilot checkride. In fact, the closest I have ever come to failing a checkride, I remember it so vividly, was my commercial pilot checkride. I can even remember the question. The question was talking about the different types of hydroplaning. I didn't know the answer. He followed that up by saying, if my tire pressure is at X PSI, at what speed would I hydroplane? You can imagine the glazed look that came over my face. And I remember him saying, if this doesn't get better quick, we're going to have to stop this. And I remember thinking in the back of my head, if I can just get to the airplane. Anybody relate to that on a checkride? If I can just get to the airplane, if I can just get through this oral exam and get to the airplane, I can show them what I'm capable of. That's not the right notion to go about things. It's great that you know how to fly the airplane, but you have to get through the oral exam here first. We're going to take you on a journey that avoids rote memorization and gets into the practical aspects, the real world aspects of what it takes to become a commercial pilot. Chapter 1, Making Sure You're Ready. What are the requirements for applying for a commercial pilot certificate? You must be at least 18 years of age, be able to read, speak, write, and understand the English language, have a current FAA medical certificate. In the aeronautical knowledge areas, you must have received and logged ground training from an instructor and completed a home study course or taken the knowledge test, hold at least a private pilot certificate, flight proficiency in all the stated areas of operations as stated in the airman certification standards, the aeronautical experience. This, by the way, is under Part 61. Please keep in mind, if you're working with a 141 flight school, their TCO, how they're approved, their standards could be much different. So this answer is for a Part 61 commercial pilot certificate. If you are flying at a 141 school, make sure you know the requirements for that 141's school. The question to ask your instructor is how many hours are required per our TCO, training course outline. But here it is from Part 61. You must log at least 250 hours of flight time as a pilot that consists of 100 hours in powered airplanes, 100 hours of pilot in command PIC time, 50 hours in airplanes, 50 hours in cross-country flight, 20 hours of training in flight proficiency areas of operations, 10 hours of instrument training using a view-limiting device, including attitude instrument flying, partial panel skills, recovery from unusual flight attitudes, and intercepting and tracking navigational systems. 5 out of the 10 hours must be in a single-engine airplane. 10 hours of the training in a TAA, technically advanced aircraft, or a complex aircraft. That's a retract, controllable pitch prop, and flaps. If you're going for a commercial seaplane rating, it must have flaps and a controllable pitch propeller. You must depart on 1 2-hour cross-country flight in a single-engine airplane in daytime conditions that consists of a total straight-line distance of more than 100 nautical miles from the original point of departure. In addition to that, you also must have 1 2-hour cross-country flight in a single-engine airplane in nighttime conditions that consists of a total straight-line distance of more than 100 nautical miles from the original point of departure. 3 hours in a single-engine airplane with an authorized instructor in preparation for the practical test within the preceding 2 calendar months from the month of the test. 10 hours of solo flight time in a single-engine airplane, or 10 hours of flight time as PIC with an authorized instructor on board. 1 cross-country flight of not less than 300 nautical miles total distance, with landings at a minimum of 3 points, one of which is a straight-line distance of at least 250 nautical miles from the original point of departure. 5 hours in night VFR conditions with 10 takeoffs and landings, with each landing involving a flight in the traffic pattern at an airport with an operating control tower. Now, everything above, you heard me use the phrase single-engine airplane. You could just as easily replace that with multi-engine airplane if that is what you're working on. There are some special cases where if you don't have a multi-engine rating just yet, obviously, you cannot go solo a multi-engine aircraft. So if you're doing your commercial multi first, you could do, and the FAA allows for something called a supervised solo, where an instructor goes with you just so the flight is legal, but says and does nothing, just sits there. They're simply there for the certification and most likely the insurance requirements. What are the commercial pilot privileges and limitations? Again, looking in part 6133, privileges for a person holding a commercial pilot certificate may act as pilot in command of an aircraft, carrying persons or property for compensation or hire, may operate for compensation or hire. What are the limitations? If the holder of a commercial pilot certificate does not hold an instrument rating, the carrying of passengers for cross-country flight for hire in airplanes is prohibited to flight in excess of 50 nautical miles or at night. So, if you do not hold an instrument rating, if you're a private pilot, you skip instrument and go straight to commercial, you are limited to exercise those privileges of compensation or hire greater than 50 nautical miles in distance, and you cannot exercise them at night. So nothing beyond 50 nautical miles and nothing at night for compensation or hire. What are commercial pilot operations? FAR 6133 discusses that you may be paid for actions as PIC engaged in carrying persons or property for compensation or hire. If you're acting by yourself, you will be a commercial operator flying under a different set of regulations. The commercial certificate only allows you to work for a commercial operator and be paid for your services. You can charge for your services with a commercial certificate for flight instruction, nonstop sightseeing flights, ferry or training flights, aerial work including crop dusting, banner towing, aerial photography, power line or pipeline patrol as examples. This is part of 14 CFR 119.1. Let's define some of those phrases we just learned and some new phrases. These next 4 questions, I promise, will be on your check ride. What does the term commercial operator mean? A pilot who flies for compensation or hire uses an aircraft to carry passengers or property. That's what a commercial operator is. A pilot who flies for compensation or hire and uses an aircraft to carry that pilot or passengers or property. What does common carriage mean? A pilot carries passengers or property as a result of advertising of this service. to the public.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.